The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is day 3 of this 7-day sesshin here at Mountain Geet in fall, October exactly, 2017. You wouldn't think it was fall if you just heard the sounds of the birds, because they're chirping and singing as if it's spring. It's very odd. But look at the weather and feel of the wind, and you know that fall has arrived. Change happens. In fact, it's the only constant, really. Yet we try to hang on to things that we like, and inevitably they dissolve. They go away, and there's pain because we tried to hang on. There's another way that is far more free, far more fulfilling, far more beginning of happiness and peace, and that is to know this deep truth that cannot be spoken of. And this is why we sit zazen, so that we can realize this truth for ourselves and reap the benefits of it. And furthermore, to be able to help other people as well, other beings, just in general. This is the Bodhisattva vow. I'd like to continue with some of the letters of Dawi, Zonggao, a Chinese master who died in 1163 in China, and who was highly revered ever since then, really, particularly in Korea, but also in Japan, and now in the United States. His teachings are profound. He was of the Rinzai sect, and Rinzai, of course, is a more dynamic teaching. And these days, it appears, well, I won't go there. So he obviously has correspondence, Dawi does, with a number of people, a number of lay people, particularly in the government. You heard in the last 2 days his letters to Vice Minister Zheng. And now today I'd like to share something of a letter conversation between someone named Bing and Master Dawi. And I'll start with a little bit of background on the first letter, which is Bing's letter to Dawi. It appears that Bing took umbrage at Dawi's continuing disparagement of the people that do silent illumination practice. The aspect of the practice that he's concerned about, that Dawi is concerned about, is this apparent urge to people to go into a place of quietism and sort of a false sense of enlightenment, really a backwater, dead end in practice, where a mind of great peacefulness is mistaken for enlightenment. And Dawi is very much against that practice because, of course, it doesn't do anything in terms of enlightenment. And moreover, people who practice it in hopes of enlightenment, well, it's a false teaching. And this man Bing, who heard of Dawi's concern about this, was quite angry and went to see him. And so there was an encounter, and Bing wrote back because something in the encounter triggered an awakening experience for him, which says a lot about Bing. So here is Bing's rather short original letter to Dawei. Recently, when I called upon your quarters and gratefully received your unsparing critique of my shortcomings, I experienced a sudden realization. So he went to complain to Dawei about his way of teaching and his disparagement of silent illumination. And he was quite angry, and Dawei pointed this out to him and criticized his whole point of view, which from Dawei's point of view was erroneous. And suddenly, to Bing's credit, he achieved an awakening experience. And then he says, looking back, I see that my mind was fundamentally dark and dull, and that all the secular knowledge I'd acquired was tainted by deluded attachment. Desiring this and rejecting that, I was like a man in ragged cotton clothes getting caught on briars as I walked through a field. But then, in a single laugh, that is all suddenly dissolved and a boundless joy arose. If not for your skillful and compassionate guidance, how could I ever have experienced this? Since returning to Guangzhou, everything is as before. Whether dressing, eating, or enjoying my children and grandchildren, I no longer feel bound or hindered. I no longer feel bound or hindered. Nor do I regard this as anything special. And this comment, nor do I regard this as anything special, attests to the depth of his awakening experience, that he would consider it just everything as usual, because that is one hallmark of awakening. Awakening is just to the truth of reality. It's not like suddenly you get this glorious, amazing insight. Any joy that comes from it comes as a result of letting go the attachments to a self-image, to ideas of how things have to be, to a need to hang on to things. But this is not special. What we awaken to is, well, of course it's like this. I no longer feel bound or hindered, nor do I regard this as anything special. Old habits and obstructions are gradually fading away. That's another sign. However, making sure not to forget your kind words at the time of my departure, I remind myself repeatedly that although I have entered the gate of awakening, he's not home free, he's entered the gate of awakening. This is another important point to recognize. You've heard it so many times here that awakening is a beginning. There's so much work to be done, letting go of our habit patterns of greed, anger, and delusion after that. And further, deeper awakenings are also possible if we persist. Hakuin reported that he had 19 major awakening experiences and countless minor insights. That's the model to follow. I remind myself repeatedly that although I've entered the gate of awakening, I have far to go before the great Dharma becomes perfectly clear. In guiding other people according to their capacities, I still feel hindered by the affairs of the world. It is my humble wish that you continue to guide me to realization of the ultimate. I pray that this request of mine is not offensive to you. Please note the humble attitude of this letter. He originally went to complain and criticize Dawei to his face. But then, somehow, that very experience, both dissolved the anger and triggered an awakening experience. It was deep enough that he could feel this humble. And this is a very important point. So I don't think I'll get all the way into Dawi's letter back to him, other than to read this part. I received your letter saying that since returning to Guangzhou, everything, dressing, eating, enjoying your children and grandchildren is the same for you, that you have no feelings of attachment and no sense that your awakening is anything special, and that old habits and old obstacles are fading away. Reading your comments again and again, I am beside myself with joy. This authenticates your study of the Buddha Dharma. Were you not such an extraordinary fellow, able in the space of a single laugh to grasp whatever you encountered, you would never have understood that there is in our Zen school a mystery inexpressible in words. Had you not understood this, you would not have never demolished the Dharma gates of doubt and anger till the end of time. The Dharma gates of doubt and anger. One of our Bodhisattva vows reads, Dharma gates are boundless. I vow to, well, there's various different readings. I vow to enter them fully. I vow to master them. A Dharma gate is exactly what happened to him. He entered a Dharma gate. This is an opportunity through some circumstance, whether it's a mind state or an encounter, where it might have at first seemed difficult or challenging. When we take it to heart, when we open to it fully and use it as a method of practice, a means to practice, it becomes a gate of awakening. Anything can become a Dharma gate. You go home and you find that something difficult has happened in your life. There's a Dharma gate right there. How will you respond? How will you see it? How will you experience it? What will you do with it? Entering the Dharma gate of that experience, you'll practice deeply, and it has the potential for awakening. Recently, I learned that a dear friend of mine in Santa Fe the email that came to me today said that she spent a week in the hospital. This is someone who is probably, she's about my age, and she has had now three different kinds of cancer. At least three different kinds of cancer. And last time I saw her, which was some months ago, her energy was beautiful, although she was not as lively as she might have been in the past. She was totally present and went to show me her most recent works of art. She's a professional artist. But in this letter, she said she'd spent a week in the hospital. I gather it was from a fall, and that sounds like it was quite a fall if it required a week's residence in a hospital. These days, they don't keep you in hospital very long unless there's some serious reason to do so. And now she's back home, and she says she feels the end is near, and it can't come soon enough, she says. I'll be going to see her the morning after Sesshin ends and hope that she's still there to see. But if she isn't, she was a Zen practitioner for a long time, and each of our encounters have been quite beautiful. She's open, and hopefully her passing will be easy, and profoundly enlightening. How many times have we encountered a situation in our life where it's been a sudden shock, perhaps, something unexpected, something was taken away from us, or something disappeared, or someone disappeared, and it's painful. And if we are a person of practice, we will use that pain to plumb deeply for the truth. The truth of the moment, the truth of who we are. And it gives us the potential, because of the pain, to awaken to that deep truth. And then it becomes a gift. So I'm going to jump here into a later part of his letter. Apparently, it was suggested that Bing consider sharing his experience and teaching people. And he wrote that he wasn't sure he could do that, given that he was still within the affairs of the world. It's hard to know whether he was still working. He was a high-ranking official. But at any rate, Dawi continues, "Long ago, I vowed that I would rather suffer the torments of hell in place of all living beings than blind the eyes of other people by misrepresenting the Dharma for the sake of people's feelings. Would that every person who teaches Zen feel the same way. If that were the case, then we wouldn't have the kinds of unfortunate abuses that we've seen over the decades, really, in Zen in America, and not just Zen in America, but other Buddhist sects. This underscores the vital importance of deep training. When I was in Yvonne Rand's kitchen one day, California, along with Haruta Roshi and Chisan, and Yvonne asked Haruta Roshi, how could someone who supposedly is awakened, who has become a Dharma successor of their teacher, he was referring to a particular person at the time, how could a person in those circumstances abuse their students? And Haruta Roshi said, they didn't spend long enough time in the monastery, which of course translates to the fact that their training was still insufficient. Whether in the monastery or out in lay life, but still doing sesshin, still training, still willing to train, still willing to open more deeply to the truth. This is a vital part of anyone who would become a Zen teacher. Long ago I vowed that I would rather suffer the torments of hell in place of all beings than blind the eyes of other people by misrepresenting the Buddha Dharma for the sake of people's feelings, or for that matter, his own feelings. You've reached this stage and know that the great matter is not something that can be received from others. So for the time being, just go on as before. You need not question whether or not you have clarified the great Dharma, or whether or not you are hindered in responding to other people. If you entertain such thoughts, then you're not going on as before. I understand that you'll be coming back after the summer is over. This brings great comfort to me in my present illness. If you were still feverishly rushing about seeking, it would be inappropriate for you. feverishly rushing about seeking. And that is not the same as sitting zazen and working to deepen your practice, open more fully to this opening that you've experienced some level of, and see clearly your habit patterns of attachment, of clinging, and working to let them go. This long maturation is vital. The other day when I observed your great joy, I refrained from advising you for fear that you would misunderstand my meaning. Now that your mind is more settled, let me advise you on how to proceed. The great matter is extremely difficult and can only be accomplished with a strong spirit of compunction. It's often the case that people of superior intelligence and ability attain awakening without much effort, thus developing a lax attitude toward further cultivation, which is extremely sad. And I have seen people have a Kensho experience and just simply not practice after that, assuming that they were home free, assuming that whatever shallow level they'd opened to, and no doubt it was shallow because that's normally the depth of a regular, ordinary, these days, awakening experience, they had no motivation to expand and deepen it, nor to make their lives in accord with what they'd realized. It was as if they'd gotten a badge and now they could go around showing it to everybody, which also says something about the lack of depth of any awakening they may have had. If you hear someone talking about my awakening, I would steer clear, because anybody who talks about it most likely has not experienced it. And they're only trying to make like they have experienced something deep as a way of expanding their ego, their self-image. Someone who's experienced a deep enough awakening simply doesn't talk about it. What's the point? It's so, of course it's like this. Nothing special. And yet that process of coming to awakening has given us a window on how it is when we let go our attachments into the fantastic, amazing, incredible, unbelievable, indescribable freedom that offers. And a taste of that freedom is incredible. It's important, I keep hammering this point, it's important that whatever level of practice you're at, you continue deepening it, because the benefits are incredible. And it's sad when someone stops short. Because if you've ever been to any depth, you know how different it can be. There's an analogy. It's as if a group of people, large group of people, set out to climb a mountain. And they're hiking up the path and having a good time of it. And suddenly they round a corner and there's this wonderful view. And some people just stop right there, hanging out in that view, enjoying that view. So then the rest of the group continues on up higher, and then there's another even better view. And some stop and stay there and never go up any further. And the group has dwindled now, and those that are left still continue going up higher. And yet another, even more incredible view. And again, some in this now smaller group stay behind, while The few that are left climb even higher. And eventually, only one person is left to go to the very top. And I hope that all of you will be that one person that goes to the very top. Because anything short of that is still vulnerable to attachment, to clinging, to pain and suffering, both inflicted on oneself as well as on others. The great matter is extremely difficult and only be accomplished with a strong spirit of compunction. It's often the case that people of superior intelligence and ability attain awakening without much effort, thus developing a lax attitude toward further cultivation. Many get caught up in the phenomena around them and never become master of their circumstances. As the days and months pass by, they wander, never turning back. The power of awakening alone cannot overcome the power of karmic conditioning. We have to put effort into overcoming that karmic conditioning. Awakening shows us the way. It gives us a sense of what we can experience 24/7 if we work towards it. But we have to do the work of letting go our conditioning in order to get there. I know people who have had sufficient kensho experiences that they're able to work on subsequent koans, which takes some insight to be able to do, at least in the Rinzai sect. And yet their daily life is still as full of attachment and delusion as it ever was. They're marking notches in their belt with each koan passed, but the practice really isn't going deeper, and they're definitely not doing the long maturation. So of you, what use is the practice then? What use was that initial insight then, if it can't be made transformative? People don't understand what can be realized and the incredible freedom, the joy, the upwelling of our innate compassion and wisdom that can function then freely. They can take place when we have deep awakening experience and continue to work on letting go that karmic conditioning. Such people inevitably come to the attention of Mara, and that's some have described it as the Buddhist devil, and are possessed by him. Even in the face of death, they are powerless. Please memorize the words I quoted to you the other day. Quote, the principle is awakened too suddenly, and with awakening, ignorance disappears. While karmically conditioned phenomena do not disappear suddenly, but are eliminated gradually. And we have to really add with effort, because we have an option. Awakening clarifies our mind state to a certain degree, and it allows us to see where we're caught. And if we turn our backs on that and rest on our laurels of whatever level of kensho we open to, we're stuck in a backwater just as much as someone who has done that silent elimination, quietistic sitting. We need to continue on. We need to let go. And the thing is that once we can see where we're caught, it's so much easier to let it go. But if there's a smidgen of ego left, and I use ego not in the psychological sense, but in the sense of attachment to a self-image, then we have a little bit of a struggle with it, because we don't want to feel like we got stuff we got to work on. We don't want to feel like we're not there yet. We don't want to feel like whatever awakening experience we've had is not profoundly deep. We want to hang on to some part of that self-image still. Yet if we don't have an attachment to a self-image, we are so free to respond 360 degrees to whatever circumstances arise in our lives. We're not caught in a trench where we have only the reactivity demanded of being in that trench with which to react to the circumstances. We're free. And that is so different. We're free to apologize. We're free to atone. We're free to change. We're free to do whatever is most appropriate in any circumstance, regardless of how it might appear to any egotist. One of the things I admired most about Kapler-Rushi and all the years I worked with him, and all the years I knew him, was that as soon as he saw where he was caught in some dysfunctional way of being, some dysfunctional behavior, that was the end of it. He was constantly working on the long maturation all the way up to the moment he died. How many people have done this? Kapler-Rushi took an awful lot of flack from a lot of people who are now shown up to be incomplete in their training. But yet he was so dedicated in his own training, continuing it right to the moment he died. This is exemplary. The principle is awakened too suddenly, and with awakening, ignorance disappears. While karmically conditioned phenomena do not disappear suddenly, but are eliminated gradually. Never forget this, whether walking, standing, sitting, or lying down. As for the various statements of the ancient masters, do not regard them as true, and do not regard them as false. As you gradually mature with the passage of time, you will naturally come into silent accord with your original mind. You needn't seek anything unusual or extraordinary. And then he quotes some three examples of people coming to awakening. Master Sri Lao, while looking for a wisteria staff in the forest, asked Matsu, that's Baso Doitsu, deeply realized master, China. Why did Bodhidharma come from the West? Come here and I'll tell you, Matsu replied. And as soon as Sri Lao approached him, Matsu kicked him in the chest and knocked him down. Sri Lao stood up, clapping his hands and laughing loudly. What truth did you see that makes you laugh? Asked Matsu. Sri Lao replied, today, the countless Dharma teachings and infinite mysterious insights are but the tip of a single hair. The bottom is penetrated. I've realized the source. And Baso Doitsu's response, he didn't pay any attention to him. That alone is a test. Was this a true insight? Or was he just pretending? Or was it something shallow that already he was attached to? I've reached the bottom. Well, When Dogen returned from China and was asked about what he'd realized there, he said, "I only know my eyebrows are horizontal and my nose is vertical. At dawn, the cock crows." Not, "I've reached the bottom." And then, one day, Master Shui Feng, seeing that Guishan's conditions were ripe, suddenly grabbed him by the chest and asked him, "What is this?" Guishan was suddenly enlightened, forgetting even the enlightened mind. Smiling, he just raised his hand, moved it. "Is there some principle you want to speak of?" asked Shui Feng. "Master, what principle could there be?" And Shui Feng was silent. The senior monk Dao Ming of Mount Ming pursued lay brother Lu, and this is the man who had just become the sixth patriarch, to Dayu Peak. Lu, seeing him come, put the robe in the bowl on a rock and said, "This robe represents faith. How can it be taken by force? You may have it." Dao Ming tried to pick it up, but couldn't move it. He said, "I came in search of the Dharma, not for the sake of the robe. Lay brother, please instruct me." Lu said, "Think not of good, think not of evil. At this very moment, what is your original face before your father and mother were born?" There's another translation of this that is a little bit more, perhaps, accurate. Something's left out here. The story, of course, is that the sixth patriarch was given the robe and the bowl that signified the patriarchy by the fifth patriarch, who said, "Now you need to leave as fast as you can, because when the others realize the robe and the bowl is gone, your life will be in danger." And so he left, and being very familiar with being in the woods, as he had been from childhood, he took off. But the next day, when the fifth patriarch failed to appear, and the monks said, "What's going on?" And the fifth patriarch finally said, the robe and the bowl have gone south," meaning he's already made the transmission to the next patriarch. And this made a lot of the monks quite angry. For one, they figured out who had disappeared with the robe and the bowl, and he was just, quote, a layman. He was not even a monk, quote, unquote. And so they went off in hot pursuit of this guy, feeling that he probably had stolen it, or if he had gotten it, he had gotten it illegally in some other way. And the first person to come close to him was a former general, this man, Dao Ming. And the sixth patriarch could see that somebody was coming, and so he just simply put the robe and the bowl on a rock. And when Dao Ming came, he tried to lift the robe and the bowl and take them away, and he couldn't. This says something about his psychological state of mind. He obviously had some doubts about whether he should be doing that. And so that's when he called out, "Lay brother, I didn't come for the robe and the bowl, I came for the teaching." And sixth patriarch then said, "Okay, let's sit Zazen first." And so they sat Zazen for a while, and this is vital. And then the sixth patriarch said, "When you were pursuing me, thinking of neither good nor evil, where then was your original face? When you were pursuing me, thinking of neither good nor evil, where then was your original face?" And that triggered an awakening in the former general turned monk. And then he asked, with tears in his eyes, he bowed and asked, "Is there any meaning still more profound than the hidden meaning and words you've just imparted to me?" There's nothing hidden about what I've revealed, replied Lu. If you turn your own light in upon yourself and illuminate your original face, the hidden meaning is within yourself. Whatever I can explain is not a mystery. And there's an eminent Korean master in history who spoke to his monks saying, turn the light inward, trace down the illumination to its original source. Trace down that light to its original source. This is what we do each time we extend the out-breath. Reaching. So fully present with the experience of the out-breath and the yearning to reach that original source. Moment after moment, we do that, filled with commitment. And of course, sometimes that commitment wanes. And we just work at bringing it back, not through intellect, not through story, but we sit and we try to reach it anyway, even if it's dry. And it'll open up again to us, and we'll plunge suddenly deeper. And we keep on going. And insight comes forth, and we keep on going. And deeper insight comes forth, and we keep on going. Infinite. I leave you with this. Do your best. It's built in. Everyone can realize this. All we have to do is give ourselves fully in each moment as fully as possible. And it's not always possible to be as fully as we think we ought to be, but we just keep trying. And with each out-breath, something is worn away of the covering that prevents us from seeing this, whatever you want to call it, that is so freeing and innate in each one of us. And thank you for listening. We'll stop now and recite the four.